All right, so let's pray together. Almighty God, we do thank you and bless your name. Thank you for keeping us alive, alive physically and alive in you. We're asking, Lord, that tonight as we come before you to dine and to eat and feast at the table of the Lord, on the word of the Lord, you'll bless every one of us in Jesus' name. We pray, Lord, that you re-emphasize and remind us what we have in you and the responsibility you are calling every one of us to. And we pray, Lord, with all devotion and commitment, we will not fail or falter in Jesus' name. The strength to do your work, the vision to keep on the assignment you have given every believer. We pray, Lord, that that commitment, that passion, that consecration, and the divine energy and inspiration you grant to every one of us in Jesus' name. And we pray that through us, in obedience to your word and faithfulness to your word and calling, multitudes will turn to the Lord in Jesus' name. Once again, we plead, open our eyes that we may behold wondrous things out of your word, and touch our hearts to rise up and do as you say. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It's wonderful to be together again for a Bible study, and we're coming back to our series in the Acts of the Apostles. The last time we looked at Acts of the Apostles, we saw in chapter 17 how Paul the Apostle and his companions, his team of workers and leaders, as well as preachers, how they went to Thessalonica, into Berea, and Athens. As you look at chapter 17, verse 1, it says, "Now when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where was a synagogue of the Jews. And as his manner was, he went into the synagogue there and preached the word." I will see the response of the people. If you look at verse 4, it says, "And some of them believed and consulted with Paul and Silas, and of the devout Greeks a great multitude, and of the chief women not a few." After that, they passed on to Berea. As you look at verse 10, it says, "And the brethren immediately sent away Paul and Silas by night unto Berea. When they came to Berea again, they preached the word of God. Persecution had risen against them in Thessalonica. But then they didn't leave until results came that many people came to know the Lord. In Berea, they didn't allow the persecution to stop them or hinder them. They kept on preaching the word and were told that people believed even in Berea as well." Look at verse 11. "These were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind, and they studied the scriptures daily whether those things were so." After that, we find Paul the apostle next in Athens. And when he was in Athens, look at verse 16. "Now while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry." Once again, he began to preach the word of God. We find in these three places in the chapter 17 that as we follow Paul the apostle preaching the gospel, evangelizing and ministering to the people in Thessalonica, in Berea, and Athens, the results were varied. And the responses of the people were different from place to place. The reactions were different as well. In one place, a great multitude. Another place, a great multitude, with the addition that they were studying the word to grow thereby. And then in the other places, in Athens, the response was not very encouraging, but still people came to know the Lord. As we look at from verse 32 of that chapter 17, it says, "And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, and others said, we will hear thee again of this matter. Then we're told in verse 34, how be it, it says, nevertheless, certain men cleave unto him and believed. They believed among the which was, we have the name there, and then he talks about other people and the woman that also believed. Everywhere there were results. You want to compare between the Thessalonians and the Bereans and then the Athenians. And which place or which part do you take? In the case of the Thessalonians, when they had the word of God, they believed the word of God. You have heard the word of repentance. Have you believed like them, like they believed? You have heard the word on turning to the Lord. Have you done that? We're not just studying to see that, okay, that happened in that place, that happened in that place. We want to compare with ourselves. You want to find out, have you responded to the word of God like they responded to the word of God? Take the first one in Thessalonica. We're looking at 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. And I'm reading from verse 5, for our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power. The word of God not coming just the verbalization of the word, the declaration of the word, but coming with power. The power that convicts, the power that converts, and the power that makes you to want to continue in the word of God. The testimony concerning these Thessalonians is that the word of God came with power and the Holy Ghost with much assurance. As you know what manner of men we were among you for your sakes. For ye became followers of us. What a great example. That as these people believed, they followed the lifestyle of the believers demonstrated in the apostles, in the preachers, and they also followed the Lord. Ye became followers of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Ghost. Yes, there was persecution. They received the word in much affliction, with much persecution, with much trouble, because the unbelievers persecuted not only the apostles but the believers as well. But the joy of the Holy Ghost remained with them. In verse 7, so that ye were examples to all that believe in Macedonia and Achaia. Can you see that since you have received the word of God, you also became an example of repentance, an example of making right your life and correcting the things that were wrong in the past, of restitution. Have you become an example in righteousness? That's what we find among these Thessalonians. They believed the word of God, they repented, they also made restitution, and they became righteous. They were redeemed by the power of the blood of the Lamb, and they became models, examples, and patterns unto all the people. It says in verse 8, for from you sounded out the word of the Lord, not only in Macedonia but and in Achaia, but also in every place your faith, your God word is spread abroad. Do people tell about your faith? Do they tell about your salvation? Do they tell about your conversion? Do they tell about the change that has come upon your life? In the case of the Thessalonians, when they believed the word of God, transformation came, righteousness came, total redemption came to them. Other people could tell a change had happened in their lives. The question is, are you like those Thessalonians? It says in verse 9, for they themselves show forth what manner of entering in we had unto you, how ye turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God. Have you turned from your idols? Have you turned from your past life? And can people testify that this has happened to you? Or they just say that, well, he's going to deeper life, but we know that, you know, he's still the same as ever. She's going to deeper life, but, you know, she's still the same as ever. There must be a change that other people can talk about. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13, it says, for this cause also, we will also thank we God without ceasing. Paul the apostle praising God for these Thessalonians, because when ye received the word of God which ye had of us, ye received it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth the word of God, which effectually worketh in you that believe. In the case of the Bereans, we come back to Acts of the Apostles chapter 17. Just to recap and to see what we learned in the past and make the connection, the link between the past and the present study. We're looking at Acts of the Apostles chapter 17 verse 11. It says, these were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind, and they searched the scriptures daily to see that those things were so. It says, therefore, many of them believed. They believed one level of believing. At the time, they had the word of God, because they received that word with all readiness of mind. Did they hear about salvation? They received it with all readiness of mind. Did they hear that if any man be in Christ, is a new creature? All things are passed away. All things have become new. They received that with all readiness of mind. There's no argument. There's no delay. There's no dilly-dallying. There's no considering, should I, should I not? There's no doubting of the word. They accepted the word. Without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. They said, yes, we believe. And then you must be saved and get sanctified and live a holy, righteous life so you can get ready for heaven. Yes, we believe. With all readiness of mind, everything they heard, they believe. But then they search the scriptures daily. In 1 Peter chapter 2, and that's what brings growth. You've heard the word, but then you do not limit hearing the word to just the time you spend at the Bible study on Monday or any other day you have the Bible study. It says that they continue searching the word, reading the word, studying the word, meditating on the word, so there will be a total change, a total transformation in their lives. I'm bringing the question back to you again. Are you like that? Do you still go over the word at home every morning, every evening? Do you search the scriptures? Or is it only on Sunday? Is it only in the congregation? Is it only on Monday when you come? They were searching the scriptures daily. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 2. As newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word, that she may grow thereby. And there is something that hinders the study of the word. Sin hinders you from wanting to read the Bible, wanting to learn from the Bible, wanting to open the pages of scripture, and wanting to study by yourself. Sin will either take the Bible away from your hand, or the Bible will take sin away from your heart. Look at verse 1. It says, wherefore, laying aside all malice, before you can really conveniently study the word, passionately study the word, and transformingly study the word, is what you have to do. You lay aside all malice and all guile and all hypocrisies and all envies and all evil speaking. Then, as newborn babes, like these Berean believers, you search the scriptures daily, desire the sincere milk of the word, that you may grow thereby. In the case of the Athenians, we were seeing that when they heard about the resurrection, they doubted, because they never thought of that before. Are you like those Athenians? When you hear something you've never heard before, you are hearing that for the first time. Resurrection, what does that mean? And instead of digging deep and looking at the word of God as to what it means, you allow that to drive you away from continuing to hear the word. Or you might hear restitution, and then what does that mean? Instead of looking at the word, how necessary is that? How compulsory is that? What challenge is the Lord giving me concerning that? Instead of examining, what should I do about that? You allow that to drive you away from the word. You hear about holiness or sanctification. Instead of going forward and saying, what does that mean? How do I have that? And what's the necessity, importance, indispensability of that in scripture? Instead of that, you allow just that one word or that doctrine to drive you away. But how be it, it tells us in verse 34 of that chapter 17, there were still people that believed. I pray you'll be counted among them in Jesus' name. And then persecution arose. But in the case of Paul the apostle, he continued with the word, because the Lord Jesus Christ had actually predicted and prophesied before he left. He said, in the world ye shall have tribulation. That means you'll have trouble, you'll have affliction, you'll have opposition, you'll have persecution. And yet he said, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached and published in all the world until he comes. We shall not allow the opposition to hinder us. Actually, persecution is the unbeliever obeying his own master. That is, the devil is the master of the unbeliever. And when you preach the light, you preach the gospel of salvation, the gospel of transformation, the gospel of righteousness, the gospel of godliness that changes a man's life. Unbelievers who don't want to change, they don't want transformation in their lives. They're not thinking about heaven. They're not thinking about Calvary or Christ or the cross of Christ. They'll persecute you in obedience to their master. But you find Paul the apostle and his companions, they said, if you are obeying your master, we are going to obey our own master too. If the sinner is obeying Satan, then the believer must obey Christ. And we must not allow those unbelievers to be more obedient to their master than we are to our master. Is the sinner, the persecutor, obedient to Satan? We are going to be obedient to Christ. Is the persecutor, is he loyal and faithful to Satan, carrying out the plan of Satan? We are going to be faithful and loyal unto Christ, our Savior, our Redeemer. Is the unbeliever, is he dedicated and devoted and submissive unto Satan, his master? We're not going to allow them to beat us, to go beyond us in obedience. If they are submissive and obedient and they are committed and devoted unto their master, we are going to as well commit ourselves unto our master, the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why Paul the apostle went on. He said, you're obedient to your master, you persecute me. I am going to be more obedient to my master, the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm going to persevere. Should you ever allow the obedience of unbelievers to their master hinder you, limit you, stop you in obedience to your own master, the Lord Jesus Christ? See what the Lord has said. And I believe that you have the grace to follow in Jesus' name. Give me a good amen over there. In John chapter 8, I'm reading from verse 31. John chapter 8, verse 31. It says, then said Jesus Christ to those Jews which believed on him, if ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. That's what disciple means, follower. If you continue in my word, then are ye my followers indeed. That could also mean the servants of the Lord. It says the master will, the servant will obey the master. If you continue in my word, then are you my servants indeed. In fact, they were ministers of the Lord. If you continue in my word, then are you my ministers indeed. Now you think of the apostles of the people that were sent out to carry out the word of God and to obey the Lord. If you continue in my word, then are you my apostles indeed. Have you noticed something there? Being a disciple is not a title that you carry, whether you obey the Lord or not. If persecution stops you, if opposition stops you, if affliction stops you, if the affliction coming from the world stops you, you're no more a disciple if you're stopped. But if you continue, then are you my disciples. Being a servant of the Lord is not a title that is there, whether you're being the Lord or not. You are a servant as long as you're obeying, as long as you continue, as long as you are devoted to the Lord. If the devotion of the unbeliever stops you, you're no more a servant of the Lord. You are an apostle. An apostle is not something you carry on the card. And whether you backslide or not, the card is still there. And whether you are still obeying the word of God or not, the card is still there. It's not a title that you carry, whether you are up or down. It says, if you continue in my word. What's his word? Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. What's his word? That you will say exactly what he has said and do exactly what he has done. And you do it until the end. And if you endure till the end, then you are going to inherit the kingdom of God. And so you remain his disciples, his followers, his servants. And you remain his, ambassadors and the workers. And you remain the apostle of the Lord if you continue in my word. And that's why those apostles continued. And he did not allow doubt, the opposition, the rebellion, the trouble coming from those unbelievers to stop them. Today we're looking at perseverance in the evangelistic ministry. Perseverance in the evangelistic ministry. And this is something you can tell about Paul the Apostle and about all the other apostles too, and all the people that gave their lives to the Lord at that time, from the believers to the ministers to the apostles to all those ministers of the gospel in the New Testament. They continued. We're going to continue. Although opposition was there, you know, if you are thinking of, I will only continue if this does not happen, that thing is going to happen. The world is going to oppose you, and some people are going to disappoint you. And if you put condition on your following the Lord, those conditions are going to drive you away from following after the Lord. But when you say, I give myself to the Lord unconditionally. Why? Because Christ died for me unconditionally. It was tough. It was difficult. Going to Gethsemane, going to Calvary, getting to the cross, shedding his blood for me. He said, if this cup will not pass by me, except I drink it, O Lord Father, thy will be done. He gave his life for you unconditionally. And that's why now you consecrate yourself, you commit yourself unto the Lord unconditionally. The devil will not drive you back. As we look at chapter 18 today, from verse 1, we're dividing the passage to three parts. Number 1, verses 1 to 11. We're talking about God's presence with the persevering apostle. God's presence with the persevering apostle. The second part will be from verse 12 all through to verse 23. And in that part, we're going to look at graceful and gracious perseverance amidst perverted adversaries. The adversaries were there. They've always been there. Satan is there. It's always been there. But thank God, God is always there too. And Jesus is always there too. His power, his protection, and his presence is always there too. And he will see you through in Jesus' name. Graceful perseverance amidst perverted adversaries. Number 3, great progress through a passionate ambassador. Passive ambassadors never give any progress. The people that are laid back, the people that are always, they do a little thing, they are tired. They walk a little way, they are tired. They preach a little time, they are tired. They work for God a little time, they are tired. They are passive, anemic. As if there's no backbone. As if there's no vision in their sight. As if they don't have any dream. They don't have any objective of serving the Lord and serving the Lord with enthusiasm and joy and excitement. And they're driven by the inner force, the dynamite of the Holy Ghost within them. If they don't have that passion, there'll be no progress. If you're going to cause progress in the kingdom of God, you're going to be a passionate ambassador. Great progress through a passionate ambassador. Number 1, we're looking at God's presence with the persevering apostle. I'm reading from Acts of the Apostles, chapter 18, verse 1. After these things, Paul departed from Athens and came to Corinth and found a certain Jew named Aquila, born in Pontus, Italy, in Italy, come from Italy. And he goes on to say, with his wife Priscilla, because that Claudius had commanded all the Jews to depart from Rome, and they came unto them. He goes on to say, because he was of the same craft, of the same trade, of the same handiwork, he abode with them and wrought. He worked with his hand, for by their occupation they were tent makers. Here we find that Paul the Apostle, he practiced tent making. And he wasn't ashamed to be employed physically and materially in a secular engagement so that he could provide for his own needs. Look at how he commented on that later, in a later chapter, Acts of the Apostles chapter 20. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 20, reading from verse 33. Here Paul the Apostle said, I have coveted no man's silver or gold or apparel. in preaching the gospel, he didn't allow money, gold or silver, to hinder him. He didn't allow the rich people to control him. Neither did he allow poverty or need or lack to hinder him in preaching the gospel. He was preaching the gospel and he was providing for himself when he could. In fact, he said in verse 34, ye yourselves know that these hands are ministered unto my necessities and to them that were with me. As we look at Paul the Apostle, we need to get inspiration from him. He was engaged sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes in secular employment. But he didn't allow the secular duty or responsibility to hinder the preaching of the gospel. Would you know that he was in the prison? He was in prison more than any of the apostles. Would you know that he wrote many epistles more than any of the other apostles? Would you know that he visited and preached the word of God in many cities and many towns more than any of the other apostles? Would you know that he exalted Christ as Savior, Sanctifier, Baptizer in the Holy Ghost and the Coming King more than any of the other apostles? And yet there were times he walked with the sun. You cannot use your secular employment, your secular engagement, your secular duty, your family responsibilities, all the other things that are challenges in life that you have to do. You cannot allow them to be excuses that, why it not for this, that's why I cannot preach the gospel. Why it not for that, that's why I could not preach the gospel. You can preach the gospel. And you will preach the gospel. You'll balance your time. You'll balance the use of your time. That you know that what is for secular is for secular. What is for soul winning and spiritual will be for soul winning and for spiritual. And nothing will hinder your effectiveness in the kingdom of God in Jesus' name. Now in verse 4, that is chapter 18, verse 4. And he reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath, and persuaded the Jews and the Greeks. And when Silas and Timotheus were come from Macedonia, Paul was pressed in the spirit, and he testified to the Jews that Jesus was Christ. He testified that, that Jesus was Christ. The people that cooperated with him, we learn of the different people in the team. But as you look at Aquila and Priscilla that he saw in Corinth, let's look at the testimony of the scriptures concerning them in Romans chapter 16, verses 3, 4, and 5. Romans 16, verses 3, 4, and 5. It says, greet Priscilla and Aquila, my helpers in Christ Jesus. Priscilla was the wife and Aquila was the husband. And here we're told about the husband and the wife, both of them helpers in Christ Jesus. The wife did not say, well, you are a man, you can go along with Paul the apostle, you can help, you can preach, you can do whatever, but I will just say, you know, stay here in the amen corner, in the intercession corner, I'll be praying for you, go and do it. But both the husband and the wife, they were committed. I pray that your family will be like that. That both the right hand and the left hand, both the husband and the wife, you'll be up and doing in the things of the Lord in Jesus' name. Look at the commendation for them and the comment that Paul the apostle had concerning them in verse 4. Who have for my life laid down their own necks. The wife was as consecrated as the husband, and the husband as committed as the wife. It's not just that he, the husband, could lay down his neck for me, but both of them, they have for my life laid down their own necks, in the plural, unto whom not only I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles. Then in verse 5, likewise greet the church in their house. Even of their substance, they have built, you know, their house, and they give that to the Lord as a place of worship. I pray that whatever you have or have house or whatever, the Lord will minister to you. And like Aquila and Priscilla did, you'll be able to lay everything down for the propagation of the gospel in Jesus' name. You know that souls are very important. Souls are eternally important. And your money, you want to spend that for the salvation of souls. Your house, you want to give that for the salvation of souls. Your car, you want to give that for the salvation of souls. You want, they still own the house. The house still belongs to them. Your car might still belong to you. But then you want to use it for the propagation of the gospel. Whatever you have, personally, you want to surrender that. And I pray that the Lord will bless and reward you for that in Jesus' name. In Romans chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 14. Here we'll find the passion of Paul the Apostle, the purpose of Paul the Apostle, and the thing that inspired him, and a principle that he had in taking the gospel from place to place. He said, I am debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and to the unwise, so as much as in me is, as long as I'm healthy, as long as I can still speak, as long as I can move from place to place, so as much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. He had preached in so many places that anybody would excuse him and say, you've done enough. Anybody could excuse him and say, you don't have to go to Rome. Another person can do that. You're not going to do everything. But he said, I'm going to walk as if I were the only one. Do you do that in your community? Do you do that in your street? Do you do that in your place where you are? Do you say, I know there are other people there, but I'm going to walk as if I were the only one. And that's what gives you passion. That's what gives you a drive within you. That's what makes you go from house to house preaching the gospel. That's what makes you go from place to place declaring that Jesus Christ is the Savior and compelling the people, convicting the people, calling the people that they should come to Christ. In fact, in verse 16 it says, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. I am not ashamed. Think about yourself. When you are in a taxi, aren't you ashamed to declare that Jesus Christ is Savior? When you are in your office, aren't you ashamed that Jesus Christ is the only Savior? There's no other name whereby we can be saved. It's only the name of Jesus. When you are in your village, when you are in your town, when you are coming to a new place you've never been before, are you not ashamed? Paul the Apostle said, you see me going from Thessalonica to Berea and to Athens, and now I come to Corinth. It is because I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. He said, there's no other way, there's no alternative. If anybody is going to get saved, this is the only way. This is the only message. This is the only Savior. And if they are not saved, they'll spend eternity in hellfire forever and ever. And because I love them so much, I'm thinking of them. I could even die for them if I had to. Because of that, that's why I'm preaching the gospel to them. When you think of your neighbors and you see them, do think of that. That if this person is not saved, and if this will be the last time I'm meeting this person, if this person were to die without Christ, without salvation, without the hope of life eternal, he'll spend eternity in hellfire. That will drive you. It will clear all the shame away from you. Why are you ashamed? Because they might reject you. Is that as serious as they spending 10 years, 100 years, 1,000 years, 1,000,000 years in hellfire? When you think of the consequence of not, they are not receiving the gospel, you will not be ashamed. You will tell them that Jesus Christ is a Savior. And as they believe, they will be saved in Jesus' name. He says to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. In fact, this is what the Lord has told us. This is what the Lord has commanded us. He has said we should do this and give the gospel to every creature. And when we do it, we're doing it in obedience to the Lord. In Mark chapter 16. Mark chapter 16, we're looking at verses 15 and 16. It says, and he said unto them, just like he's saying unto you, because Jesus has not changed. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. What he told them is telling you. And what he tells you is telling the rest of us. He's saying, go ye into all the world and do what? Preach the gospel to every creature. The gospel. That's the gospel of grace, not the gospel of condemnation. The gospel that saves. The gospel that tells us, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But that's not the end of the story. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But Jesus Christ loves us so much. He died for us. And you can believe on him today. And when you believe on him, you will be saved. He will forgive all the sins you ever committed in your life. And that's not the end of the gospel. And as you have grace to continue, eventually you'll get to life, Peter, you'll get to heaven. Go ye therefore into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. The question is, have you believed? But the question is, that follows is that, have you been baptized in water? In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. If you say you believe, have you accepted to touch of the word of God? And the beginning of that acceptance is, you are baptized in water. And it's in the name of the Father, Son, of the Holy Ghost. Then it says, he that believeth not shall be damned. He that believeth not shall be damned. I pray you will not be damned. That means you have to believe the word of God you are hearing. It's not enough to just hear it. It's not enough to just know it. You must act on it. You turn away from sin. You believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you're saved. Think about it. That just 5 minutes, all that can be done. And you can escape hellfire forever and ever. Just turn away from your sin. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. You're saved. Then you are baptized in water. And to delay that until tomorrow, until another tomorrow, until another tomorrow, and you are getting nearer and nearer, perdition, damnation, doom, condemnation, and eternal lake of fire. And you can just arrest that situation right now and say, yes, Lord, I repent. Yes, Lord, I believe. And hand over yourself to the Lord. And within a few minutes, the deed is done. And you're saved. I pray you're the wise. In Matthew chapter 28, I read from verse 18. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and on earth. No other person could have said that. And no other person can say that today. Only Jesus Christ could say that. What a great privilege for you to follow Jesus Christ that has all power. All power in heaven. All power on earth. There is no other person you can follow. There's no other person you can believe. There's no other personality you can follow and give your life to that can say that. It's a great privilege for you to understand who Jesus is, that he has all power in heaven and on earth. And then that you follow him, and that power will work for your progress and for your protection in Jesus' name. It says, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Go ye therefore. Go ye therefore. That's what go is given to the whole church. Now, if everybody in the church were like Paul the Apostle, the world would be won in no time at all, in a very short period of time. But if everybody were like Demas, who loved this present world, the job, the gold, the silver, the money, the social things, the amenities, the infrastructures, loved this present world, and is departed unto Thessalonica, not to go and preach, but to go and do business. If everybody were to be like that, the world will not be won for Christ. Why don't you make up your mind and say, even if I'm not able to go to all the other countries, but to the houses nearby, to the communities nearby, to the local governments nearby, and to the regions nearby, just go a little beyond your house, a little beyond your local church, and do something and be part of this great move of God. Then it says, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always. He will be with you. He says, I am with you always until the end of the world. The presence of the Lord. The Lord will not leave you. He will not forsake you. Let's come to Acts of the Apostles chapter 18. And see the promise of the Lord made to Paul the Apostle. And the promise is making to you and to me as we continue preaching the word of the Lord. Persecution also arose at this time because those who follow Satan, anywhere and everywhere, their commitment to Satan is always the same. Whether it's in Thessalonica or in Athens or in Berea or it's in Corinth, anywhere you find followers of Satan, they do the same thing. Shouldn't that challenge us that anywhere you find the followers of Jesus Christ, whether you find them in Thessalonica or you find them in Berea, find them in Athens or find them in Corinth, we should also be the same. If the disciples of Satan don't change, if they are all the same and they do persecution every time they find somebody preaching the gospel, why is it that believers are different from town to town? Why is it that those who say they are following Christ, they're different? Paul is preaching, others are not preaching. Paul is praying, others are not praying. Paul is winning souls to Christ, others are not winning souls to Christ. We must be the same. We must share that same characteristic. And as we share that characteristic, the Lord, its promise will be for you. It says in chapter 18, in verse 9, then spake the Lord to Paul in the night by a vision, be not afraid, but speak, and hold not thy peace. Be not afraid, but speak. What makes us to keep quiet and silent, seal our mouths, not speak, is fear. Fear of what? Fear of the wrong thing. If we ought to fear anybody at all, it should be God. If we ought to fear anything at all, it will be perishing forever and going to hell. That's what we should fear. But we fear the wrong thing. We fear Satan, who is conquered already. We fear evil spirits or evil powers who are conquered already. We fear men and women, and they cannot go beyond whatever limit God has given them. Even persecution is limited by God. We fear what we shouldn't fear, and we don't fear who we should fear. But he says, fear not, but speak. Why did God say that? Look at verse 10. For I am with thee. He is with me. He is with me. I said he is with me. When he said he is with you, will he fail? Will he fail you? He's nearer to you than those persecutors. He's with you all the time. He says, I am with you, and no man shall search on thee to hurt thee, for I have much people in this city. You shall have that promise of the Lord with you all the time. When there's a soul to be witnessed to, when there's a duty to be done, when there's a ministry to carry out, understand, whatever the challenges are, the Lord will be with you. He will never leave you. He will never forsake you. Hebrews chapter 13, I'm reading from verses 5 and 6. Hebrews chapter 13, I'm reading from verses 5 and 6. It says, let your conversation be without covetousness. And it says, be content with such things as ye have. For he has said, because he has said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee, so that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper. Will he help you? The Lord is my helper. I will not fear what man shall do unto me. I will not fear what man shall do unto me. Think about it. When people fear, what does it hinder them from? Number one, when you fear, it hinders you from getting saved. What will my neighbor say? What will my friend say? What will my girlfriend say? What will my best friend, my best friend, what will he say? Boyfriend, what will he say? My boss, what will he say? Mother, father, what will he say? What will they say? My children, what will they say? And the people who know me to be the socialite or the socialite, the one that is the clown of the whole community, what will they say? Fear makes people not to get saved. When you hear about without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. And in your heart, deep down in your heart, you want to get to heaven. And the Lord is saying, as long as the sin is clinging to your soul, to your spirit, to your inner man, it's going to hinder you from getting to heaven. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Who shall appear? They say, I say, to the heel of the Lord. They that have clean hands and a pure heart, those who have not lifted their souls unto vanity. You hear about that. Why are you not made holy? Why are you not sanctified? I'm afraid shall become holy, holy, and then people will be looking at me. They're looking at you that you are nearer heaven than hell. That's great. You're nearer Christ than Satan. That's good. And that your mind is not totally in the Lord rather than in the world. That's better. But you're afraid. It's the fear that hinders you from getting sanctified. Why do people witness, evangelize, do so winning? The Lord has said, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Why are you not doing it? Fear. It's because of the fear. That's why you are not doing soul winning. If you are not holy, it's because of fear. You know, somebody comes to bring temptation your way. And it says, now get this. They might say, get me. It might be a lady that says, get my body. I give my body to you. Or a man that says, you know, I need your body. And because of fear, you are not able to say no. But it says, the Lord is with me. And because the Lord has said, is with me, I will not fear. Can you say that? I will not fear. I want to hear you say it. I will not fear what man shall do unto me. They can do nothing. I said they can do nothing. The Lord will protect and preserve you in Jesus' name. And you know, when you listen to those people, you become fearful. And then you either could go to commit sin, you are fearful, you do not do what the Lord has told you to do. You will not be able to use you for what he said he'll use you for. He says, I have much people in this place. I pray that fear will get out of your heart today. You always look at God, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. All fears will vanish in Jesus' name. I come to point number two now, graceful perseverance amidst perverted adversaries. Amid perverted adversaries. Before I go to Acts of the Apostles chapter 18, can I read to you from 1 Corinthians? I'm reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 16 and we're looking at verse 9. 1 Corinthians, we're looking at chapter 16 and we're looking at verse 9. It says in verse 9, for a great door and effectual is opened unto me. There's an open door before you. Door of opportunity and door of soul winning and door of success and door of progress. The Lord loves you so much, he has opened the door before you. But you know, there are adversaries standing nearby. If you're looking at those adversaries and you're not looking at Calvary, you're not looking at the cross, you're not looking at Jesus Christ, who is the conqueror, who has conquered Satan, has conquered all adversaries. If you exalt the adversaries above Christ, you will not do what the Lord has called you to do. You'll say, I fear them, I think of them, they might do this, they might do that. Are they greater than your God? Are they greater than your Christ? The Lord has commissioned us. He has opened the door. And he says in this life, this is the door I want you to go through. And this is what I want you to do. And now you are fearing an adversary. They will not answer for you on the day of judgment. You cannot say on that final day when the Lord will open the books and look at what you've done and what you should have done. And then he says, this is what you should have done. And this is what you have reached. You should have reached. If you were not looking at the adversary, if you were not looking at opposition, if you were not looking at those persecutors, if you were not looking at the lion that was chained already, if you were not looking at them, this is what you would have done. And on the day of judgment, the day of reckoning, nobody will answer for you. And the adversaries will not say, Father, pardon him. I hindered him. I did not allow him to obey you. I did not allow him to do everything he should have done. And on that day, your mouth will be closed. I pray you'll wake up today. And all those adversaries, you look away from them. They are nothing and they can do nothing. They will not hinder you. They will not stop you. If they are obeying their master Satan, you will obey your Lord and Master Jesus Christ. For a great door and effectual is opened unto me, and there are many adversaries. And let's come back to this Acts of the Apostles chapter 18. I'm reading from verse 12. And when Gallio was deputy of Achaia, the Jews made insurrection. Insurrection, that simply means an uprising, a revolt, and opposition, rebellion. and goes on to say, with one accord against Paul, and brought him to the judgment seat. They accused him, saying, this fellow persuadeth men to worship God contrary to the law. And when Paul was now about to open his mouth, Gallio said unto the Jews, if it were a matter of wrong or wicked lewdness, O ye Jews, reason would that I should bear with you. But if it be a question of words and names and of your law, of your religion, look ye to that, look ye to it, for I will be no judge of such matters. Here we find that Paul the apostle was accused. And as the accusation came, then the person that should judge it said, if it's about your law, about names, about that and that, I don't have any business with that. I know my calling. And a lesson we learn from this, if Gallio knew his calling, and he said, I'm not going to get into what I'm not called to do, and what I'm not going to be rewarded for. That's not what the government is paying me for, and therefore I'm not going to get involved. Do you do that in your life? Do you make a difference between your calling and just the casual things that come to you, or the casual things that people bring to you? If we start from the overseer, national overseer, what's your primary calling? And what's the primary commission? And what are the other things that people are bringing? Look into this, look into this, look into that. Is that part of your primary calling? Are you wasting much time, much of your life on things that God is not going to request from your hand on the final day? You're a pastor of a local church. What's your primary calling? You're a teacher of the word of God. What's your primary calling? Or maybe you're a Christian worker in the vineyard of the Lord. What's your primary calling? If you are diverted to things that you are not called to, that God is not going to reward you for, what are you going to say on the final day? And then it says in verse 16, and he drew them from the judgment seat. Then all the Greeks took Sosthenes, the chief ruler of the synagogue, and they beat him before the judgment seat, and Gallio cared for none of those things. Now they became aggressive, and they beat this man, but Gallio cared for none of those things. There are the things people will do to distract your attention, just to get your attention. To say, are you not interested in this? Are you not going to get involved with it? Are you not going to get involved in that? And then they do some things that will push you to say, I thought I would not get involved, but I think I need to get involved now. But this man was wiser than that. He cared for none of those things. Put first things first in your life. Major or major things in your life. Do not allow non-essentials to cancel your devotion, your commitment to essential things, important things, indispensable things that the Lord has called you for. I pray God will give you wisdom. It goes on in verse 18. It says, and Paul, after this, tarried there yet a good while. After this, after the uprising, after the opposition, after the persecution, after the false accusation, and after the insurrection, he tarried a good while. He didn't allow those adversaries and those adversities to drive him away. I pray that nothing will drive you away. And he came to Ephesus in verse 19, and he left them there. But he himself entered into the synagogue and reasoned with the Jews. That's what you'll find him doing everywhere. Go to chapter 14, it's there. He reasoned with them in the synagogue. And go to chapter 17, it's there. He reasoned with them in the synagogue. Now we come to chapter 18. He reasoned with them in the synagogue. A person that makes it a habit to do the right thing, and to do the good thing, and to do the rewardable thing, and to be committed to the same thing anywhere and everywhere. That is not saying, I've done that before in chapter 14. I've done that before in chapter 17. Now I can relax and go on vacation. Every time, every day, you are committed to that good thing the Lord has committed unto you. And that is the wisdom of Paul the Apostle. And that was the devotion of Paul the Apostle. He says, and when they desired him, in verse 20, to tarry, longer time. Well, then he consented not, but bid them farewell, saying, I must by all means keep this feast that cometh in Jerusalem, but I will return unto you if God will. And he sailed from Ephesus. He left that place and went to another place. You see, Paul the apostle, persecution had been there, affliction had been there, difficulties are there, adversaries are there, the commitment was always there. And I pray that that same passion, that same devotion to the word of God, that same commitment to the work of the Lord will grant unto us. There's something we learned about Paul the apostle. He practiced what he preached. He practiced what he preached. What did he preach? Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 58. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58. It says, therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast. He was talking to the Corinthians, and you know, he's been in Corinth, and he has preached the gospel at Corinth. And now he was talking to the Corinthians and said, my brethren, beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Always abounding in the work of the Lord. There are people that know how to counsel others, don't counsel themselves. There are people that know how to challenge others, they don't challenge themselves. There are people that know how to command others, they don't command themselves. There are people who know how to compel other people, and you must do this. This must be done. This is your duty. This is your responsibility, but they don't do that for themselves. Paul the apostle, he knew how to challenge other people, but to challenge himself too. Compel other people, he compelled himself to. Commanded other people, but he commanded himself to. Look at this. He said, be ye steadfast. He was steadfast also. And it says, be unmovable. That's exactly what you find about Paul the apostle. What he requested, required of other people, he also did. And then he goes on to say, always abounding in the work of the Lord. He says, don't let any day pass, any week pass. Count that week a waste if you do not abound in the work of the Lord. Count that month a waste if you do not abound in the work of the Lord. In soul winning, in evangelization, in edifying the church, in building up people, in strengthening the people of God. If any week passes, if any month passes, a year passing, that you do not win any soul to the Lord, count that year a waste. It says you should always be abounding in the work of the Lord. But that's exactly what he did himself. Then he said, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. He knew that his labor was not in vain in the Lord. Come back to Acts chapter 18. Acts chapter 18, I'm reading from verse 23. And after he had spent some time there, he departed and he went over all the country. He went over all the country. He went over all the country of Galatia and Phrygia in order, strengthening all the disciples. As you look at that verse, you find that what Paul the apostle did, he did it relentlessly. He did it consistently. He did it devotedly. He did it systematically, in an orderly fashion. It's not just like hit and run. It's not like, where do I go today? Where am I going tomorrow? He planned everything. Look at that verse again. He departed and he went over all the country of Galatia and Phrygia. He said, that town, Jesus died for them. I must not miss that out. He said, that locality, Jesus died for the people there. I must not miss that out. That country or that region or that vicinity, I must not miss anything out. He was relentless about it. He was consistent about it. He was orderly about it, systematic about it. And then he said, he did that in order, one after the other. And then he goes on to say, he strengthened how many of the disciples? Tell me out loud. All the disciples that he strengthened. If that is what he did, we can do it. I said we can do it. And it is commendable that also to only Paul the apostle alone that was committed. Not only Paul the apostle alone that was persevering. All the other apostles too. Look at Acts of the Apostles chapter 5. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 27. It says, and when they had brought them, they sent them before the council. And he and the high priest asked them, saying, Did not we strictly charge you, command you, that you should not preach in this name, you should not teach in this name? And behold, ye have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine, and intend to bring this man's blood upon us. That could intimidate anybody. These were the people, the power of the land, the power of the day, and the power in that nation religiously. And he said, didn't we, authoritative people, didn't we, the people in charge, didn't we, the religious leaders, hierarchy of the land, didn't we charge you, command you, didn't we tell you not to teach in this name? But you have not obeyed us. Look at verse 29. Then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than men. I think that's true today. God is still greater than men. Am I right? And if there's anybody that demands obedience and loyalty, we ought to obey God rather than men. In fact, these were wicked men. If we're even going to obey man at all, shouldn't be a wicked man, shouldn't be a person opposed to Christ. But these are wicked men, even good men. We ought to obey God rather than men. No matter how good those men are, how generous those men are, how loving, how affectionate those men are, they're still less than God, far, far less than God. And if we make any comparison between God and good men, God is greater, God is higher, God is mightier, and God is eternal. And those good men, they are not going to determine what happens to us in eternity. God is going to determine what happens to us in eternity. That's the reason why we always say, we always have that at the back of our mind. Whatever is happening, and whatever man, whatever woman may try to pull us, and you know, tying some strings on your feet and saying, you know, come back, don't do that. Then you always say, those men may be good, those women may be good, those men may be loving, those women are loving, those men or women may be affectionate, but all the same, we ought to obey God rather than men, rather than women. I pray God will grant you that same passion, that same decision in your life in Jesus' name. We're looking at chapter 26 of Acts of the Apostles. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 26. I'm reading here from verse 19. And this ought to be your testimony when you come before anyone, Agrippa, or any other person. In verse 19, whereupon, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient unto the heavenly vision. I was not disobedient unto the heavenly vision. If you're reading any book or found these people that say they are successful, you know, they've done this, they've done that, they'll tell you that, when they decided we're going to either run a race or do a business or, you know, float, whatever it is, challenges came. But they said, I had the dream and I knew I could do it and I knew that I will be there. And there were things that tried to come against me, even broke my leg or, you know, shot me down, whatever. But I still said, I must obey, I must follow this vision. All you can say about that vision is as an earthly vision. Earthly vision. Any of them could say, I succeeded because I made progress because I came to this big peak because I was not disobedient to that earthly vision. But the earthly vision is no comparison, is no way to be compared with the heavenly vision. The vision that comes from heaven. The vision that comes from Christ, the vision that is going to take multitudes to heaven, and the vision that is going to give you reward in heaven. If the people of the world are saying that I closed my mind, I closed my eyes, I just, you know, went on, I was not disobedient to the earthly vision, how about the heavenly vision the Lord has given you? that was to win souls. It will bring you reward in eternity. You should wake up in the morning and examine your life and say, by the grace of God, looking at the past and looking at today and looking at my commitment in the future, I will not be disobedient to the heavenly vision. May it be so in your life in Jesus' name. In verse 20, but showed forth unto them of Damascus and at Jerusalem and throughout all the coasts of Judea, and there and then to the Gentiles, that they shall repent, that's heavenly vision, and turn to God and do works meet for repentance. For this cause, for this reason, because of this, the Jews sought, caught me in the temple and went about to kill me. Verse 22, having therefore obtained help of God, I continue unto this day. And every day in his life, he continued. You will continue. We're looking at the third point now. The third point is a great progress through a passionate ambassador. We're coming to Acts of the Apostles chapter 18. And I'm reading here from verse 24. Acts of the Apostles chapter 18. And we're reading from verse 24. It tells us in verse 24, and a certain Jew named Apollos, born at Alexandria, an eloquent man and mighty in the scriptures, came to Ephesus. And this man was instructed in the way of the Lord, and being fervent in spirit, he spake and taught diligently the things of the Lord, knowing only the baptism of John. And he began to speak boldly in the synagogue, whom when Aquila and Priscilla had found, they took him unto them and expounded unto him the way of God more perfectly. And when he was disposed to pass into Achaia, the brethren wrote exhorting the disciples to receive him, who when he was come, helped them much which had believed through grace, for he mightily convinced the Jews, and that publicly, showing by the scriptures that Jesus was Christ. Here we find this ambassador, a passionate ambassador. Look at the quality of the qualifications of the man. Number one, he was a Jew. His name, Apollos. He was born at Alexandria. Alexandria was a major city in Egypt in those days. There was a great university there, and more than likely he would have been trained or taught and trained in that university at Alexandria. And we're told that he was mighty in the scriptures. That just means that he understood the Old Testament, the way John the Baptist understood the Old Testament. And he came to Ephesus. And when he was there, we're told he had been instructed in the way of the Lord. He was fervent in spirit, and he spoke boldly. He talked diligently the things concerning the Lord, but knowing only. Underline that. Knowing only. Notice that. Knowing only the baptism of John. Here is where many people make a terrible mistake. You see somebody that is speaking forcefully, that is speaking courageously, that is speaking boldly, and is referring to the scriptures, Old Testament scriptures, but his knowledge was limited to that of John the Baptist. His knowledge was limited to that John the Baptist knew before Calvary, because John the Baptist had died before Jesus went to the cross. In fact, before he died, he said to the Lord Jesus Christ, he said, are you the one to come, or shall we wait for another? And the Lord sent back to him that he was the one, by because of the signs and the wonders that were being done. And he said, blessed are those who will not be offended at him. But this Apollos just knew that. And many people do not understand. Somebody is talking about repentance, and he speaks about that forcefully, just like John the Baptist has spoken about repentance forcefully. And then they come back, they say, I've seen a man is just like us, and he knows the scriptures. He talks about repentance. Wait. Maybe he knows only all that John the Baptist knew. And then he comes and talks about righteousness, bring forth fruit that is meet unto repentance. And then you come back to say, I found a man. That man emphasizes righteousness. In fact, as you read about John, he emphasizes restitution. But wait, you need to go beyond just repentance and just restitution and righteousness. And that's what Aquila and Priscilla, that's what they noticed in the man. They saw the limitation that he had. He did everything he could do with all that he had, which is commendable. His knowledge was limited, but he was passionate about it, fervent about it. He was excited about what he was saying. And he spoke with assurance and confidence. That was good. But there was still a limit. That's why we're told in verse 26, he began to speak boldly in the synagogue. When Aquila and Priscilla had heard, they took him unto them. This husband and wife, they noticed that something was missing. I'll show you now what was missing. And because of that, they took him and they expanded the word of God unto him more perfectly. And it was teachable. He accepted that. He didn't say, Priscilla, yeah, woman, what have you got to teach me? I know this, I know that. Did you see me passionately defending the word of God, speaking from the Old Testament? He didn't say that. He was humble. He was teachable. And he heard them. And with at all the effect of that, look at verse 27 now. Because he had received a better knowledge, a better understanding. And when he was disposed to pass into Achaia, the brethren wrote, exhorting the disciples to receive him, who when he was come, he helped the church much, which are, that is, those who have believed through grace, because he immediately convinced the Jews, and that publicly, showing by the scriptures, because of the knowledge he has now got, that Jesus was the Christ. What did Aquila and Priscilla achieve? What did they do? Number one, they said, move on from John to Jesus. Very important, very important. The people that are passionate, they're very zealous, they're very active, they're aggressive, they go here and there, they talk about holiness, but it's the holiness of John, John the Baptist, external holiness. But go from John and go to Jesus, the one that gives us the internal holiness that affects your heart, that transforms you, that there is a power from within that helps you to be holy, rather than coming from the angle of John, the power that comes from without, from your willpower. Just, I will not do that, I will not do that, I'm going to control this, I'm going to discipline myself in that. The holiness that comes from John is not as deep as the one that comes from Jesus. Move on from John to Jesus. What they told him, what he taught him, was to move him from Jordan to Pentecost. Here at Jordan, there was water baptism. But then, he had not known about Pentecost at all. He had not known about the coming of the Holy Ghost. That the Holy Ghost of John spoke about it. He said, he is coming. The one who is coming, he'll baptize you. It was the Holy Ghost and with fire. But that thing had not happened until John the Baptist died. John the Baptist only spoke about it. He didn't experience it himself. And now there's a man, Apollos, he knew about Jordan, about water baptism, repent and bring forth fruit, meet unto repentance. You'll be baptized in water. Yes, that's true, but there's spirit baptism after that. And so you should not be carried away because somebody is speaking forcefully and aggressively and is convincing everybody. You will notice what he's saying. Is he limited to the knowledge of John the Baptist, or has he gone beyond Jordan and has he gone towards Pentecost? Number three, they were telling him, move from salvation and move to sanctification. Jesus prayed for the sanctification of the church, but before Jesus prayed that prayer, John the Baptist had died, because Jesus in chapter 17 of John spoke about sanctification and prayed on sanctification. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. That was the last week of his life here on earth. John had already died. And John did not know anything of that heart circumcision. in the practical terms. He didn't know anything of that deep work of grace in the heart. Yes, salvation, all the hills shall be leveled, and all men shall see the salvation of the Lord. John knew that. But now move from salvation and move on to sanctification. What they were telling him, Aquila and Priscilla, is, Apollos, so far, so good. You've spoken about limited redemption. That he is coming, the one that will redeem us, but you've not gone far enough. I move from limited redemption to full redemption. Christ died on the cross of Calvary. He has redeemed us from the curse of the law. All the limitations we had in the old covenant, all those limitations are gone. Move on from that limited redemption and come to full redemption. As you look at John, did you remember that when John saw Jesus coming, he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Yes, that's what he said. That's the redemptive Lamb. Redemptive Lamb. But before John died, he was wondering whether Jesus Christ would be the reigning king or not. He had not seen that happen. And what they were telling him is that Jesus Christ now has died, and Jesus Christ was buried, and Jesus is risen, and Jesus is now at the right hand of majesty on high. They were saying, Apollos, so far, so good. But move on from the redemptive Lamb unto the reigning Lord. Now, if you think about the ministry of John the Baptist, look at John chapter 10. John chapter 10, I'm reading from verse 41. John chapter 10, we're reading from verse 41. It says in verse 41, and many resorted unto him and said, John did no miracle. John did no miracle. But all things that John spake of this man were true. Now the point is, John spoke about miracles. He said, if you close your mouth, God is able out of this stone to raise up children unto Abraham. He believed in miracles. He professed miracles, but he never performed any miracle himself. And so what they were telling Apollos is that what the message you are carrying is limited. And the power you carry is limited. And go from professing miracles to performing miracles. In short, they were telling him, you know, Apollos, everything you are talking about, that's the old covenant. That's the old covenant. It was mighty in the scriptures of the Old Testament. But he said, the new covenant has come. And Christ, the mediator of the new covenant, has done everything now. That the benefits of the new covenant are now ours. He has given us promises, but that by these will not be escape the corruption that's in the world. They were telling him, move on from the old covenant to the new covenant. And the same thing we need to say today, that sometimes you might find there's a preacher there, another preacher there, another preacher there. They're speaking forcefully in a dynamic way. And they even talk about holiness and righteousness. And they talk about repentance, talk about water baptism. But you should compare what is said with the totality of the scriptures. And if you have opportunity, you'll be telling them, why don't you move on? Why don't you move on? You can move on from John to Jesus. You can move on from Jordan to Pentecost. You can move on from salvation to sanctification. You can move on from limited redemption to full redemption. You can move on from the redemptive Lamb to the reigning Lord. And you can move on from professing miracles only unto performing miracles. You can move on from the old covenant and moving on to the new covenant. And I pray that as this man was teachable, you will be teachable. As he was humble, you will be humble. And then as he did everything that you ought to do in the power of the Spirit, after he was now instructed and he accepted all that, and he got into these new experiences, I pray that the new experiences will be yours as well in Jesus' name. In conclusion, here is what the Lord is telling us, telling you and telling me, and what we learn from this passionate ambassador. I'm reading from 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 18. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18, but grow in grace. You've got some measure of grace, But grow in grace. You've got some humility, grow in humility. You've got some holiness, grow in holiness. You've got some experiences, grow in those spiritual Christian experiences, grow in knowledge as well. And in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, to him the glory both now and forever. Amen. As you grow, I pray that God, through your life, will receive more glory in Jesus' name. Let's rise up now and talk to the Lord in prayer. We've heard a lot today. We've learned a lot today. We've seen a lot today. We need to bring that to the Lord in prayer, that the Lord himself will move you on. Will move you on. You will grow in the mighty name of Jesus. Check up your Christian life. Are you like the Thessalonians receiving the word of God? Are you like the Thessalonians turning away from idols to serve the living God? Are you like the Thessalonians? You've heard the word. You find it not as the word of man, but as it is the word of God in truth. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord, that God will help you, that you'll have the appropriate Christian experience. Let the Lord transfer the knowledge from your head to your heart, granting you real salvation, eternal life, a real transformation, change of life. That your life will not be the same again because you've heard the word of God. And pray that God will help you to be the Bereans that heard the word of God with all readiness of mind. And they were searching the scriptures, studying the scriptures by themselves, committing themselves to the scriptures, wanting to grow in the knowledge of the Lord, in the things of the Lord. And pray that whatever may be the attitude of the Athenians, their persecution, their opposition, their false accusation, their name calling, as those persecutors are obedient to their own master. So you will be obedient to your own master, the Lord Jesus Christ too. Sinners will not obey Satan more than you will say to obey the Savior. Don't allow the obedience and the faithfulness and the loyalty of those unbelievers put you to shame. But the Lord will say unto you, look at how sinners obey their master. How are you obeying me? Look at how persecutors obey their master. How are you obeying me? If I'm your master. Look at how those idol worshippers and loyal and faithful to their idols, to Satan, to the evil one. How are you faithful unto me? How are you loyal unto me? How are you committed, devoted unto me? The Lord has said, he'll never leave you, he'll never forsake you. That's why you say, therefore I will not fear what men will say. I will not fear what men will do. If you fear the adversary, you're exalting the adversary above Christ. If you fear any man, any woman, you're exalting that woman, that man above Christ. As if they can hurt you, but God cannot help you. You believe their threats more than you believe the promise of Christ. That's why you fear. But the Lord is saying, don't keep quiet. Open your mouth. Talk about me. Preach. Win the souls to Christ. No man will set on you to hurt you. I am with you. I have much people in this place. Let not the opposers of the gospel stop your obedience to Christ. Are you like Apollos? Fervent? That's not enough. Zealous? That's not enough. Bold. That's not enough. Mighty. In the scriptures. That's not enough. Move on. Move on. From John to Jesus. Move on. From Jordan to Pentecost. Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? You're sure of your salvation? Have you been sanctified, purified, made holy, pure in heart? Move on from salvation to sanctification. And the Lord is waiting to baptize you in the Holy Ghost. Move on. You shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And you shall be witnessing unto me, both in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the uttermost part of the earth. Move on. You know the redemptive Lamb, the one that takes away the sin of the world. Do you know him as the reigning Lord? Is he reigning in your life? Ruling in your life? Controlling your life? Directing your life? Move on. Move on from your knowledge of limited redemption to the experience of full redemption. The benefits and the blessings of the new covenant are waiting for you. Move on.